Is your medication helping or hurting you? Find out at drugsafetynews.com.
News outlets have been buzzing this week as armed right-wing terrorists took over a federal wildlife building in Oregon, while the federal government greeted the situation with a fairly large yawn. At the same time as the occupation, a special prosecutor in Cleveland announced that the police officer who shot and killed 12-year-old Tamir Rice would not be facing criminal charges. There are two separate justice systems in America, and I have political commentator Chauncey DeVega with me now to tell us why this is. So Chauncey, earlier in this week, I pointed out, and I still believe this is absolutely correct, that if the terrorists, is what they are, in Oregon, had a skin tone that was a shade not milky white, they would already be so riddled with bullet holes that you wouldn't even be able to identify the bodies. Now, kind of cut a little bit of heat for that, but I still stand by the fact that I firmly believe that that is what would have happened had these been black people, Muslims, anything other than white people. We would have been looking at an absolute massacre on the news instead of just a bunch of white guys holed up in a federal building.
Yeah, white ISIS would have been immolated and ventilated. And I think that the fact that you have folks, and I don't know if they're just delusional or in denial, who would argue the obvious opposite, who would actually say, well, you know what, this isn't about race. You can just look at the media framing. If you go online, and you know, I've done this and others have done it at Salon and elsewhere, my own site, chauncedevega.com, just look at some of the titles. Armed protesters, peaceful protesters, occupiers. If they were black or brown, they would have been called terrorists. They would have been called militants, and they would have been called radicals. And just think about what's going on in that small town in Oregon. They've actually shut down the schools. People are afraid to go outside. The FBI and the sheriff's department are finally starting to corral these characters and try to isolate them and cut off their supplies. But if they were Muslim and black and it put a majority white city under siege, they would be dead.
And, you know, it's very interesting because we're looking at a situation, things like this have happened in the United States in recent history. The most recent one obviously being the little Bundy Ranch saga, which, you know, Bundy's sons are now up there in Oregon with these people. And again, we had white people pointing AK-47s. I mean, the infamous picture, that guy on the bridge pointing that assault rifle at federal agents. That alone, even without pulling the trigger, is a federal crime. Now, there was not a single prosecution. Nobody that occupied the Bundy Ranch went to jail ever for anything they did there, at least. And so we contrast that with what is happening in Cleveland this past week, where we actually did have peaceful, unarmed protesters who were angry about the fact that police officers killed a 12-year-old child for having a BB gun in his hand. Only because he was black. I mean, if Tamir Rice had been a white child, he would be in school right now. I mean, that's the difference in the justice systems in America. Police officers, if it's a black person, it's shoot first, no accountability later. White people, it's all right, well, hold up. Let's try to figure something out. I know they've got guns, so let's just, you know, talk it out. I honestly, sometimes you don't even recognize this country when you see things like this happening.
Well, we had a case, I believe it was down in Texas or Alabama or New Orleans, somewhere in the South. You actually had two black cops who acted irresponsibly and killed a white child, and they were arrested and put in jail, which is exactly what should have happened in Cleveland. And I wrote a piece that went viral, about 350,000 shares at least online, and I basically pointed out the obvious. There's a cartoon that contrasts an NRA member who's a quote-unquote militia member or patriot, that's how the media would frame him, with Tamir Rice, or a young black child with a toy gun who'd be described as a thug. And I was thinking about this yesterday. I was on Tom Hartman, and we were going back and forth about this, and I said, you know, we have this moment of Black Lives Matter, but when you have these moments with Bundy's brigands, which is what they are, they're a bunch of welfare cheats who want to steal public land and not pay taxes, it really makes me think about another slogan, white lives matter. Because when white conservatives, because if they were liberals or progressives like Occupy Wall Street, they would have been shot dead, at the very least, or put in jail. But if you're a white conservative with a gun who's engaged in cowboy cosplay, it becomes white lives matter, and you immediately have to de-escalate the situation. But if it's a 12-year-old black child, or a man smoking, selling loose cigarettes, or a black person sleeping in their car, the police officer is immediately in fear of their life and, of course, should be given broad latitude to kill somebody. It's perverse and it's a moral abomination.
Well, especially in the case of Tamir Rice, the police officers rolled their vehicle up, you know, just a few feet away from him. stepped out of the car, shot.
Yep.
No words were spoken. I mean, we've all seen the video, and that's what's the most damning thing here about the Tamir Rice situation is that the prosecutor, the special prosecutor in this case before the grand jury, absolutely could have secured a conviction or at least a trial in as quickly as that officer pulled the trigger. I mean, he could have shown the video and said, well, this video speaks for itself. Instead, the special prosecutor obviously had an agenda to push, and that's why there's no prosecution. These police officers are going to continue their jobs. Sure, maybe they'll get transferred to another state or somewhere else where they're not so recognizable, but it's going to happen again, just like with the original Bundy ranch. No accountability, no federal involvement to speak of, and so they go and they do it again, and they escalate this time. Now they've actually taken the federal building. I mean, you know, when you see things like this happen, what could the government do right now with these terrorists up in Oregon?
Well, they should enforce the law, number one. So these terrorists actually do meet the legal definition of terrorism. They've taken a federal building and they're threatening to use force. They recorded martyrdom videos. Imagine if a Muslim brother or an African-American brother, even a Latino or a First Nations brother or sister recorded a martyrdom video against the federal government telling them, if you come here, we'll kill you and we're prepared to die. So it's the very definition of both terrorism and insurrection. What they should do is surround them, starve them out, use the same drones they used to spy on the protesters in Ferguson and in Baltimore, keep them under control. And the sheriff apparently came out just a few hours ago, and I couldn't believe this. And he said, well, if they surrender, maybe we can work this out. They'll face some charges, but if they just surrender, it'll be okay. I'd love to see that reaction, especially thinking about Fox News. If these are black or brown folks occupying a city or a town, I don't care if it's 10 people or 1,000, it would be 24/7 news coverage. As of now, they're quiet as a church mouse.
Well, and what's interesting, too, is that for 48 straight hours, we're seeing stories where the police officers say, okay, well, we're going to cut the power. Mm-hmm. We're going to cut the power. Cut the damn power. Get them out of there. Do what you have to do. I mean, if the power company is watching the news, maybe they should just say, you know what? I'm just accidentally going to flip this switch. I mean, this, to me, is appeasement. I mean, we're doing everything that they want to do. And the government is not demanding anything from them. They're letting them go about with their little insurrection. They know that they're armed to the hilt. But my God, aren't the National Guard armed? Isn't the Army armed? We don't have to kill anybody. We don't have to fire a single shot. But that threat of force, you know, I don't know why they're not doing more about this. I mean, we should send them a message and say, look, you guys have about 1 hour to get out of that building, or else when you do get out, you're on a one-way plane down to Guantanamo with the other suspected terrorists. And these guys would actually be terrorists at that point.
Well, there's a whole lot going on here that we have to be careful with, too. Number one, these folks are a creation, and they're coddled and encouraged by the right-wing corporate media. So they're called patriots or a militia. They're neither patriots nor militia. They're terrorists and they're insurrectionists. The other real deep angle we really need to, you know, some folks have done some good writing on this, is there's a clear causal arrow here with this escalation in right-wing domestic terrorism and the conclusion with an event like Waco or the Oklahoma City bombing, right? So we know how this could very easily end up. And again, you have the deep pockets. A lot of these folks really are enamored with this old-fashioned manifest destiny cowboy vision where they want to take public land, give it to private interests like the Koch brothers so they can then go and exploit all the resources. And that's the real deeper game here. They can call it patriotism or they can call it malicious stuff. It's really about stealing public land so they can give it to private corporations.
And what's interesting, too, is that we finally have some Republican presidential candidates come out saying, okay, you guys need to surrender. But when we look at it, when we're talking about causation here, the language that these Republican candidates use, the language that Fox News uses and Alex Jones and Glenn Beck, that language spurs these people on. In the age of Obama, we have seen the rise of these militia groups. Their numbers have absolutely skyrocketed after plummeting during the George W. Bush presidency. This is a racial issue. They are doing this not because they are patriotic, not because they, you know, have real disputes over land. This does have to do directly with the language being used by Republican candidates and the media and the fact that we have a black president right now. I mean, there is absolutely a link between all of those, and the media is not talking about any of that right now.
No, they're not. I mean, there's an interview with one of Bundy's brigands. I don't know which of the two sons it is. And it really is madness filtered through stupidity. But he's recycling this understanding of the Constitution that's right out of Glenn Beck. The idea that sheriffs have ultimate authority and that, you know, the federal government doesn't have any control of the area and that these public lands belong to these cowboys and that they're under, quote unquote, a tyrannical government that's telling them that they must protect a wildlife reserve. This is really, really scary stuff. And as we've said repeatedly here on Ring of Fire, and I've written about elsewhere, Salon, ChaunceyDeVega.com, Alternate, the right-wing media has weaponized its public. And then when they act out, when they kill somebody, when they plant bombs, when they threaten to kill folk, then they stand back and say, oh my God, how did this happen? Bundy's brigands are a creation of the right-wing, conspiranoid, Fox News, Alex Jones hate machine.
And, you know, the biggest issue is that this isn't necessarily going to go away. When these people eventually do surrender, which is probably the only outcome here, I don't think we're going to see any real action from the government or the local authorities there to force them out. I think it's going to be these people coming out and they finally do surrender. That's not going to solve the overall problem because we're still going to have people like Donald Trump out there telling us that, you know, immigrants are an enemy. Black people are the enemy. Muslims are the enemy. And until we fix the language, we fix the media, things like this are only going to continue to escalate, I believe.
Oh, yeah, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, this is a function of our political moment. You have scared, anxious, and just nervous folk out there because their life chances are diminishing. But this right-wing militia stuff, this goes all the way back, you know, certainly to the 70s, probably the 80s, reaching its apex, and now it's resurgent. But again, you don't have the corporate actors, you don't have the Republican candidates, you don't have the folks who've created this machine taking any personal responsibility. And they love that word, personal responsibility. And again, going back to the obvious contrast, if these folks were black or brown, if they were Muslims, they would be called terrorists, militants, or thugs, and they'd likely be dead. But if you're white, as I said before, and you know Tom Hartman last night, it's the complexion for the protection. But not all white brothers and sisters, only conservatives. Because if these were liberals or progressives who were talking about forming a grange association or taking land back from these corporate farms or fighting Monsanto, my goodness, they would be under the truncheon, they would be beaten, they'd be locked up too. But again, if you're white and conservative with a gun, if you're an ammosexual cowboy cosplayer who's fed it on Fox News, then you're protected.
Chauncey DeVega with ChaunceyDeVega.com, Salon.com. Thank you for telling us this story. We're going to check back in with you frequently throughout this entire year. We always love having you on, and thank you very much for talking with us today.
Thank you for having me.